keep pressing on. Right? You gotta get some coffee, get a little Joe, right?
Yeah.
All right, Psalms chapter 106. I saw a post on Facebook today. It says, what do you do when you're ordered to wear a mask by a man who wears a bra? So I shared that with my kids, of course. They need to be in on that madness, that ridiculousness, amen. They're like, oh, I didn't say that. Yeah, that's that guy or whatever. His name was Richard Levin. And he, in 2011, decided he was not going to be Richard anymore. He's going to be Richard. And because our United States of America is so woke or whatever, you won't just pull out everything. You didn't just, I don't know, man. It's just good to be saved. It's good to have a Bible, amen, and some people to hang with that aren't crazy yet. Hope you don't. Amen. You just got to stick by stuff, amen. And Lord Jesus Christ will be back soon enough. In the meantime, we just got to plow through. There are times where we get tired and we don't feel like it. We don't want to just kind of give up and let the world go to hell, right? Just let them go. They want to go anyway, right? They'll tell you. They'll say, I'm going to hell. They'll sing about it. And so I remember them days. I don't know if I really was that guy that there are a lot of things I agreed with when they said stuff like that. For whatever reason, even before I got saved, the songs like Highway to Hell or Hell's Bells, you know, when they got Satan talking in the first person, Satan's gonna get you, gonna take you to hell. That, I mean, I don't even know the craziest scenario. Why would you, like, because as far as I knew, that was like fire and smoke coming out of those volcanoes, right? And yeah, get popped by that great good bacon grease, I wasn't like, woohoo, yeah, woohoo. All right, Psalm chapter 106, let's pray. Father, thank you for Jesus Christ. Thank you for your Son, Lord, everything that he's blessed us with. Father, I pray you meet with us this evening. Lord, I pray you to help us where our need bunch. And we just need guidance and encouragement. And Lord, we just need to be reminded of the purpose. And so we do thank you for this church. I pray for a hedge of protection about your saints. Encourage, definitely pray for the Kelly family. We lost Sister Eloise, and she was a blessing to everybody that knew her. Father, she was a blessing to us, the Barnett family, through the years that we were both in Florida. And Father, whatever ailment she was going through up to that last few days, though, that's no longer. So we just thank you for that. So we plead the blood. We definitely pray you come soon.
Amen.
Keep Manny's dad in prayer as well. I don't know. I don't remember us bringing that up. Maybe we did. I didn't catch that. But how's he doing?
I came in prayer.
Yeah. Are they done or are they still not done with that?
Still good. Still not.
So, yeah, please keep that. Keep his mom. You know, what a blessing, you know, on Sunday after we broke to head out to the street. And there she was. And it was like, wow, okay, amen. And, of course, I don't speak fluent Spanish, but she was rattling off to my wife something about, like, well, why aren't we walking in the middle of the street? You know, we pass the tracks, and I think, what about all these people? And I get in the zeal, I was like, amen, you know, and we've done that before. You know, just at this moment, we are doing what we're doing and how we're doing it, and you just pray about it, we can take another step. We do, after we're done, go back into the parking lot and fast tracks out and go that route. So we do see that, but I get it. We've done that before. Pray about this coyote next year. It comes in, what, April? Is it May? Anyway, March this year?
It
probably won't happen. But that is a great opportunity. You know, literally a million people, you know, that go down there. Of course, if you go early, because by the time lunch comes around, they're all drunk. Ridiculous. But, yeah. The idea is to get that word out. Does that make sense to you? Because that's why we're here. The idea of, well, you know, we're just kind of just skating along and just doing what we got to do to get through life, that ain't the purpose. Now, that happens, and I'm with you there. I was laying on my couch before I came here, amen. My wife was tutoring, and, you know, I dozed off, and it was very wonderful. And I was la-la-land, and then my phone went off, and it was like, snooze one time. And then before the snooze came back on, I got up, and all right, get geared up, and so, you know, do our thing. Lord, look for effort. And we have responsibilities. Your day's coming. You're going to look back. I don't know if you will look back. If that Bible says, forgetting those things which are behind, and the idea that in eternity you're going to constantly turn on, Dade County, the first series or the first season, second season, the third season of Dade County, or this was your life, I'm not connecting to that thought, amen. I think, but you're going to be so happy to be up out of here, and you're not going to want to, who cares, right? And I'm actually getting that way now. You got to be careful. You don't want to get apathetic, that's the word. You don't want to get to the point where you're just shrugging your shoulders and let your neighbors, do what they got to do like that without hearing about Jesus Christ. But as far as getting excited about anything, I don't know, what? I'm all ears. I mean, I've been down that route. Sports was very big for me growing up, and even my Christianity, a lot of that. And I'm not saying don't watch it. Do whatever you do, man. You're not under the law, right? Be fully persuaded in your own mind. Whatever you're going to live, however you're going to live it, be ready to protect it if somebody asks you questions about it. That's all. Don't be offended if somebody asks why you do what you do. Just do what you can, and this, Bible is going to help. Amen. And you have a prayer life. The Lord will guide and direct you through that. And if you're curious about if the lifestyle you're living today pleases him, ask him. Psalm chapter 106. Praise ye the Lord, amen. And that's a good thing. We do that. We sing songs, amen. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he's good, right? So they say, God is good. And we say, all the time. All the time. And they say, God is good. Why? Well, according to David here, it's because his mercies endure forever, right? So he says, praise the Lord, give thanks unto him, right? He's good. And then the reality of his goodness towards you, since it's like that. So there's a God in heaven, but if he's not a personal God, he's not personable, doesn't actually affect your life one way or another, then there's really not this God. That would be the fourth, right? If Star Wars, whatever. That's this inanimate object, this thing that really doesn't care too much about what you do every day. However, this God in this Bible is not that God. This God here is worthy to be praised, amen, because of his intimate desire to want to intermingle, amen, and be a part of your entire life, amen. From the time you wake up, even while you're sleeping, I guess, he's watching over you. He's making sure that your lungs are still functioning. You've got a heart that's still beating, amen. And the idea would be that, you wake up with him on your mind. And I think that's the right way to handle your Christianity. Amen. And I believe that's how this God is. And there's a mercy connected to your God that endures forever. Amen. Now, in your case, of course, you never have to worry about losing your salvation. Amen. You're saved. You're sealed unto the day of redemption. And if God never provided anything other than your eternal life, promising you that level of eternal security, then that would be plenty. Because there are just millions of people in hell right now. And there are just millions of people right now that aren't in hell, or maybe billions of people, right? I'm not sure how many people are on planet Earth. But there are billions of people on planet Earth, and they are going to go to hell. And they're going to be miserable. There's going to be weeping, and there's wailing, and there's gnashing of teeth, amen. But the reality of the day you trusted Christ, that made it to where that was never going to happen. You don't have to worry. There are things in life that you do got to pay attention to. Your electric bill might be one of them. I don't really care about that. Your electric bill, your responsibility for your dad, your wife, amen, your mom, and doing your thing, and you have little babies here now, and you have work, and you have these different responsibilities. But the risk of you slipping off and you get T-boned, amen, or somebody sneaks up behind you and robs you, amen, and shoots you and pitches you off into eternity, well, the eternity that you'll be pitched off into goes up. Amen? Glory to God for it. You'll be absent in the body. You're seated with him already in heavenly places. You want me to explain that? I don't know. other than you're in Christ, and according to the Bible, he's you seated. He's seated. So if you're in him, that's why Paul said you're seated. Anyway. Verse 2. Now who can utter the mighty acts of the Lord? That's the question. And who can show forth all his praise? So I went over this actually with my kids today. It was part of our senior class. We went over Psalm chapter 106. As part of sometimes the preaching sounds like Charlie Brown's teaching. But that's a good question. Go ahead and answer it. Who can utter the mighty acts of the Lord? That would mean that you had an opportunity, you sing a song, count your blessings, name them one by one. You'll be surprised to see what the Lord has done, right? And that would say, that would be the practice of taking a piece of paper, and you start writing all the great things God's done for you. You go, he saved me, I can hear, I got two eyes, we get real deep. And I would tell you, as deep as you think you're getting, as much as you think you're identifying God Almighty and praising him and thanking him for all that he's doing, right now, you're going to miss the majority, because there's just so much to God, amen? And we're just so finite, and we're so selfish at times. It's well, me, and then I don't know, me, and then some me, and then a little bit more me, and me, and then some me, and that's like, I don't feel like it, I don't want to, okay, I'll do it, all right, okay, nah. And that's your Christianity today, sad deal. But if you were to ask that question, who can utter the mighty acts of the Lord, you can. We can start, and we preach often about it, and we'll try to point out as much as we can. But I don't know until you hit heaven, until you hit the judgment, until you see Christ, until you put on the incorruption, that you'll ever fully understand what God's doing, or what he is, or who he is. I mean, you can't see him. I mean, they say seeing is believing, and I get there's a lot to that in this life, in the flesh. But God said, you're not going to see me, and I promise you, the way that is, think about that for a second. So, he knows us, we have eyes, but yet we can't see him with our eyes. We have ears, yet we don't hear him with our ears. That's a weird thing, you know? So, you made me? Yeah, you're fearfully and wonderfully made. All right. Well, then how come I can't see you then, if that's that right? And that's just the sovereignty of God, all right? And it's just the what you doing? Now, he probably knows. You ever see a kid up just sitting there and they go, and you're not doing the woo-hoo and the whatever, he'd just be sitting there going, okay. I bet, man, Lord's like, hey, daddy, come over there. You know, I saved him, man. He didn't deserve it, but I saved him. Yeah, that's good God. Anyway, you've got this God that created you, and yet, you know, gave you the eyes, and you're talking and whatever, and yet none of that is what you use to really communicate or to connect with God. Although I guess the mouth, because you praise him according to how this works. But know that the exact way that God set everything up is perfect. Isn't that wild? Because it doesn't seem that way at times. It's like, Lord, we need an answer to this question. And it was like, I heard God, somebody say, man, God would only write it down. Who can utter the mighty acts of the Lord? I'll say, I'll answer for it, right? Nobody. Not all that. He couldn't do it. There's just so much there. So much more than they say that needs the eye. You ever heard that term? who could show forth all his praise? The answer to that is absolutely nothing. You know what it is? So we're just prone to do our own thing, amen? We're just, prone to kind of go through motions at times. You ever felt like that going through life? You just kind of put things in neutral and you kind of skate by and there's, yeah, I'm there, but I'm not there. I'm here, but I'm not really here, type stuff. And I think God sees that and he recognizes that. He understands it, what life is. He lived life, by the way, right? He was all man. That's why he died. And he's all God. That's why he came up. Amen? That's the reality of what you have. So maybe in the Old Testament, you could probably make an argument to say, well, God, you really don't understand what I'm going through, amen? Now, though, you're in the New Testament, and he went through this life of yours. He was born in a barn, amen? You probably weren't. You probably born in a hospital, right? You probably had a lot more than he ever did while he was here. He didn't have AC. You do. He didn't have a vehicle. You do. Amen? He didn't have HMOs or whatever. He didn't have urgent care or whatever. You do. Amen? He didn't have Pollo Tropical or whatever. You do. And so he knows now. He knows what you're going through now. And that's why I don't know that the message ever changed. So you have the Old Testament saint trying to... the Old Testament saying he's referring you back to the book, and the New Testament saints referring you back to the book, and it always comes back to the book, amen? Why? Because, again, we're prone to be that individual. We're prone to make those excuses sound like they're normal, amen? The whole, I don't really care too much about this, I'm just here because they're there. And that's a sad way to live out your Christianity. When you read about people getting hold of God, they don't act that way. Matter of fact, they love God. There's songs written about your Savior. There's over, I think, somebody said 5,000 songs written by one man. Amen. And that's why I like those old time hymns. I appreciate when I had an opportunity to come visit for the first time. I had no idea what to expect. I assumed, though, if you were going to call me, there wasn't going to be a big old trap set. You know what a trap set is? That's your drum sets. I would imagine there wasn't that. Although Rosario wasn't very detailed about it, he surely didn't tell me about the hot box. And so he said, come on in, I got a sound guy. A sound guy, wow. Because I never had a sound guy. I thought, to be honest with you, when I thought you had a sound guy, I thought, well, that's pretty high cotton, man. It must be a pretty big to do if you've got a sound guy, because I've seen sound guys, and there's 50 people, there's 100 people there, sound guy. And I walk in the back, and I'm like, whoa. And then Scott said, hey, how you doing? I'm Scott. I said, oh, you're the sound guy. And then he pulled out a little radio with a CD on. I said, all right, God. I said, all right, Lord. He said, that's right, that's your crew, man. And I thank God for it. You know, I appreciate that little testimony when Kyle came in. I can't imagine my wife and I, you know, our family, my daughter. Where, you know, you sing that song, where could I go, oh, where could I go, where else could I go but to the Lord? And I say this to you, where else could we go besides Victory Baptist Church, amen? And who else would we serve? What would we do without Victory Baptist Church? What would we do without you? I don't know. And I guess for right now, anyway, until the Lord comes back, I don't have to answer that question. Look at verse 3. Blessed are they that keep judgment, and he that doeth righteousness, how often? All the time. And so I would ask my kids, I said, at what time can't you do right? So how often are you expected to do right, right? And that would be a question I would ask you. How often are you supposed to do right? In every situation, most situations, or whenever you feel like. According to this, it sounds like you have an ability to do right all the time. And then they would be like, oh, well, that's interesting, because I thought we're all sinners, and when there's none righteous, no, not one. Right, but when you say that, are you saying that the unrighteousness that you have is somebody else's fault? Yeah, it's true that you are. You do come short of the glory of God, and it is true that you're unrighteous, and you know, all your righteousnesses are filthy rags. I get that, as the Bible said. But then let me ask you this. Well, whose fault would that be? Because sometimes we say that, well, we're sinners. The difference is we're just forgiven. It's almost like you use that as an excuse so that you can sin, and then say, well, see, look at me. I told you I'd go to fall short. Yeah, but that's a lack of character, amen, and discipline on your part. I don't read anywhere in the Bible that you have to sin. You're given a choice like everybody else, and it seems like the closer you get to God, the least likely you sin, amen? Bible says, be holy, for I am holy.
Right.
It says, be holy. So what does that mean? Of course, the biblical, it's not really meaning, but it's not. Well, all right. Well, because here's another verse that kind of goes that. And he says, verse 3, he goes like that. And says, and he that doeth righteousness at all times. Blessed are they that keep judgment. That's good. Go back to the blessings in life. I want a blessed life. Amen. All right. Keep judgment. Poor judgment not to get closer to God. Poor judgment not to pay attention to this ministry. Poor judgment. Now, can you skip out? Can you do what you want to do? Can't you? You're not under the law. I don't know that God's going to kill you. I mean, he hasn't yet. And you ain't all that. Amen.
Right.
I'm not all that. Amen. I know who he calls. I know how the Lord, not many of you know, mighty and all that. I know why he picked me. I don't know why he picked me, but I know who. I've read my Bible. I know who he picked, man. Not many, whatever. And it's like, well, because he just can't find anybody worthy to go, so he found people like ourselves to do his work. Amen.
Yeah.
But that Bible's very clear, man. You're supposed to do right all the time. Well, you got it down to where, oh, I do right. You go that route. That's how you say that? That's not what the verse said. But you say it like, if you're not careful, you're like, well, I do right. Yeah, I do right. You do like that. Yeah? Like, in front of you. Oh, okay. And in front of my wife, I do right sometimes. Well, most of the time. Okay, well. That Bible says you're supposed to do right at all times. Yeah. All times. The real you, and we said this, right? The real you is not the person that shows up in church. The real you is the person when nobody else is around. You have every temptation that's out there to man, especially with this technological whatever. And you can get on these computers, and you can get on these iPads, and get on these places, and you can drive around, and you can get caught up in all sorts of stuff. Real easy. Right? There's a type of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, I would say that would be your internet. Because you can click on one page, and there you have some stuff that you can put in a bulletin, you can use for illustrations to put a message together, amen? And, bro, you click another click, and then off you go. And it just behooves me that parents, sadly, they just hand these kids these devices, amen? These instruments. And they just don't pay attention, because you're actually, you know, in order for you to be a good parent, it takes effort. The idea that somehow the kid was going to take care of itself because you got better things to do. What better things do you do other than spend time training up that kid? Oh, yours, by the way. And mine. I already did mine, right? And all five of them, glory to God, they're all saved. Now, outside of my house, I encourage them. I can't thank you enough that when I brought my oldest daughter here and she said nothing but good things, at least to us, that she felt very comfortable, there's a good crowd, amen, and she sent us a group text to all my kids and used terms like blessed and all the rest of that stuff. You say, well, that's kind of milky. That's, yeah, but, right, that was a little bit for us, for her mom and mine. So. And for her to sit there and, you know, you get to preaching like we can get sometimes in this church, and she got 3-4 services for that. Gave us kudos and thanked Daddy and cried and I cried a little bit and we all cried, say goodbye and stuff like that, amen. That's really good stuff. So I would thank you for making her feel that way, amen. And we all got our moments. That's why I say as a church this size, man, be careful. Man, we gotta be as close and in as we possibly can, you know. I knew you guys were like a cold line, man, whatever, man. That's just your dumb way of thinking things, but I mean, you know, that door swings both ways, man. Don't let it hit you where, you know. But I would prefer you to. I prefer that you learn the vow and evil. I prefer that you recognize the importance of serving Jesus Christ. I prefer that. Why would you prefer that, man? I'm reading what you're supposed to be reading, man. Who can utter his mighty acts? Who can utter the mighty acts of the Lord? Who can show forth his praises? Blessed are they that keep judgment and that do righteousness all the time. Verse 4. Remember me, O Lord. Because you're going to need that, by the way. You see that? You praise God and you identify the great things about your God. And then it starts kind of curving into, well, there's a little stipulation there in verse 3. And then once you nail 3 and you're doing right, things are humming. And then he throws in verse 4, those two words in verse 4. And you might say that, you know what, that's not real important to me because, again, my Visa card's okay. I had maxed out on that. Still pretty healthy for the most part. I've skipped church many times. I am in and out of the ministry, and I'm still standing, right? And you're just an idiot. No, don't say that. You're a fool to be able to say something like that, knowing that in a second, in a blink, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, your life will change. Right. If God feels fit, He'd snatch your kid. What you gonna do about it? The Lord give it, and the Lord take it away. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Amen.
And go ahead and just keep neglecting that Bible. Go ahead and keep neglecting the fellowship, amen, the assembly. Go ahead and neglect your responsibility as a Christian and let life come knocking. And then what you gonna do? Because it comes from unsaved people. That wasn't my mother that passed away. Not last night, it was another brother's mother. And what's he doing right now? Well, I'll tell you one of two things. One, he's sorrow, but not as others sorrow that have no help or hope out of that. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Yeah. He is going to miss his mama. We miss his mama. She's a very good lady. And she, anybody that knew the lady was blessed for knowing her. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Sister Kelly. And she was just that lady. She, no matter what, she always had some kind of ailment going on, but was never missed church. She'd always have a little something going on. I remember, and you kind of look at people like that, and you're like, wow, you have a hard time walking. All right, see you later. Well, people do that. You got Manny's dad, man. The guy's missing a foot. Missing part of his foot. And we're like, yeah, let's pray for that. Anyway, what's up, Billy? I'll read this again. Who can utter the mighty acts of the Lord? Who can show forth all His praise? It's a question you need to whoop. See, man, if I can figure God out, it says, praise ye the Lord, give thanks unto the Lord, for He is good, and for His mercy, rather, endureth forever. Boy, if that was like, that mercy's limited. The only reason why any of us are still able to sit down in a chair and come to a Wednesday night service is solely because of His mercy. And only because it endures forever, because every last one of us should be dead right now. For the wickedness and the laziness and the corruption and the scheming and the lying and the messing around, amen, and just getting caught up in everything that this world has to offer, amen, should have all been dead a long time ago, amen. Yes, amen. You should be dead right now. You should be hung up, but guess what? You don't look like you are. You're here. I'm tired. You tired? We're tired. You tired? You ready to go to sleep? Right now. I'm going to sleep right now. So I'm going to say goodbye to you after we close. And I'm going to go home. I'm going to brush my teeth. I'm going to pray a little bit, man. I got my Bible read early. And I'm going to sleep. And then another day starts. Well, what about that day? Well, that's kind of like today's day. What happened today? Well, today's a little different, guys, because we were getting ready for church. And we had to do it. You dusted off the Bible a little bit, at least to carry it around for one day. But it's on now. Thursday comes Friday, and Friday comes Saturday, and then we stay up till 1, 2 o'clock, and we'll figure out a way to get to church eventually. And, sometimes not always, because I got that pain. Man, on my neck. You know, my head hurts, man. You know that it's all going on. You know, your left hand came down. You know how this goes. You're forgetting this guy here, this wonderful God of ours. The Bible says, verse 4, hey, remember me, O Lord. With the favor that thou bearest unto thy people, visit me with thy salvation. Now, your salvation is settled, but, you know, there might be a point where you need some saving. Amen? Your salvation is settled in heaven. Christ said it's finished. But He says here, remember me with the favor that thou bearest unto thy people. Now, that point, a bunch of Jews right there. But this point, as we're preaching tonight, how it's applicable here, you're grafted in, amen? You're part of God's family. You are His people now. Now, that don't mean we're getting on the Jews' promises, amen? We're not going to do like, what's his name? Steve, see how you guys mean? He probably can load all down with all his videos, man. DVDs, whatever, yeah. Anyway, so we're not going to do that, but can you apply an Old Testament text that says, remember me, O Lord? You think that's like, well, no, we write in the Bible. You can't claim that one. Oh yeah.
Because I've been out of dispensation for a long time because I pray that quite frequently. Lord, remember me when I'm dealing with these people here. Lord, remember me when it comes to being a husband to that wife. Lord, remember me when it comes to being a dad to that little girl right now, with my daughter. And all the other ones that are around, all my other four other ones around, they're all going through their own little problem. And they're little to me because I'm 500 miles away. But to them, it's, oh my God, Dad, I don't understand what's happening. Just like you, like your little problem. You say, ain't little to me. I know, they're yours, it's not mine. And then my problem to you, yeah, go on and have your little problem. And then we go that route. Everybody's got problems, so. You know what verse will help you? You want me to help you as your pastor? You want me to give you a little deep verse to help you with your problems?
Yep.
All right, verse 4. Remember me, O Lord, with the favor that thou bearest unto thy people. Oh, visit me with thy salvation. Save me, Lord. I'm about to make a mess out of some stuff. Lord, save me from making a mess. Save me from saying all the wrong stuff because here's so-and-so coming around the corner, Lord. You know, but here the problem comes is that we constantly forget, amen. You forget what God did yesterday for you. You forget that He saved you and really what all that meant. And so we just kind of lackadaisically focus and stuff. And then very frequently we forget verse 4. You forget that. You forget to ask Him. Because you know what happens is you get into this little rut, right? And you get into this little deal where it ain't quite so bad. I mean, I still sleep okay. I can take a pill for that. And you can do this, and then you can do that. And then, you know, really, man, this whole kind of Christianity thing is not as important as the guy over here makes it out to be. And when this guy keeps telling you, man, be here, man, let's hit the streets, let's go, whatever. And I've missed it many times, and I'm still good, man. I still have both legs. No God struck me down yet. So I'm kind of good. And therein lies the subtleness of the devil. How you've just allowed him, how the work that God Almighty's done thus far to get you propped up to the position that you're in, that you could be a Christian mom and a Christian dad. You weren't that way 2 months ago. You weren't a Christian dad a few months back. You might have been a Christian husband, maybe go that route. Or maybe a Christian single guy or whatever. You weren't. And then as time progresses, things change. And at what point do you say to God, I'm good, right here, that's what you're saying, I'm good. I'll give you a little nod every now and then, but this life of mine, this beautiful, wonderful Egypt that we have before us, I'm good. And yes, okay, yes, you brought me this far. And yes, okay, you saved my soul, and I can't wait to get to heaven. But, man, who are you talking to like that? Wait, can you... Son, you hearing this? Yeah, they talk to you like that? Those three guys, man, why do you keep dragging me into this place? Don't you realize God sees everything? I'm part of the Trinity, man. I mean, if it was just us, man, we could kind of get away with it. I won't say nothing between us. I kind of like it, man. I've been with you. You're my buddy. But you know this level of communication, everything you do, say, hear, touch, whatever, goes right to the throne. You know that, right? Aren't you understanding that? I mean, I wrote the book. I can guide you and I can help you, man. And you live a Christian life, right, man? It don't even matter. Whether you're here or not, don't matter. Nothing that you live like that lines up with the book. I mean, there are sections there that you do line up, but it's always bad. It's past stuff. That's bad stuff. You being rebellious and hateful and selfish, you know, that Bible likens your life then, you know, you can live a cursed life as a Christian. You wouldn't think that, huh? You wouldn't think, nah, I'm saved, huh? And a lot of them kids, because they simply don't know. Whether they don't want to know, whether they don't want to know, or it's because they just don't know yet because of the church they're in, maybe the pastor doesn't go that deep. Maybe doesn't peel back a layer of onion like that. But trust me when I tell you, and if you're here long enough, we point a lot out that, you know what, you could be here and just be miserable as all get out, because you're just scheming, you're just doing two things. You're just deciding that today's your day, and it never is today. This is the day that the Lord is doing. It's the Lord's. Everything's the Lord. Oh, you're at, let's close with this, though. Let's close. Go to Ezekiel 28. I read this morning. or today. Actually, a guy preached on this. Ezekiel 28. Now, this is the king of Tyre. And basically what this is God Almighty talking about actually the devil. But watch, but as the king, as a man, though, I want you to see if this couldn't be you. Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 1. You've got to remember, God, remember this, God. Remember the opportunity and the love that he's giving you, man. You remember that he gave his son. Son, you got to go down and pay that price for this guy right here. You're like, that guy, man, come on, man. Look at him. He's nasty, man. Bitter, man. He's upset. He hates me. He cusses me out all the time, man. I got to die for him. And you know what your Savior did when giving that? He said, okay, I'll take it from you. That's why, as a pastor, I don't understand at times. I get the flesh, I do. Well, when, if at all, are you going to take that Christianity of yours to another level? Are you not ready yet for that? It goes in levels. I think it does. That's why I do go over this all the time, too. First grade, second grade, third grade. The idea that you're comfortable, man, second grade, and but you've been saved for 12 years, I don't understand that. You're not getting anything out of it. You cannot keep reading doctors, you gotta move on from being. It's a great book, yeah, it's just a classic, right? Not reading it. But man, there's so much more out there for God to give you, and you just sit there and you're like, well, I'm good at this being exam, pretty simple stuff. I'm good, I'm satisfied with my deal. That's because 90% of your Christianity is nothing but flesh. And you got your cable television. But you're in debt. You're in bad debt. And you don't know what's going on. And if the bank decided today's the day I need all that money back, you couldn't do that. You don't have it.
Right.
But instead of living responsible and learning, you know, that godliness with contentment is great gain, you constantly keep building on your debt. And then you got so much stuff, man, that you literally can't park your car in the garage. I mean, that's me. It's trash. You're not as happy as you can be. I'm happy. Not as you can be. You can give me a lot of happiness. Your life can be more for you. My world's pretty good. You're settling for the black meat. You're settling for the Esau thing. You're settling for the stuff that you're going to wind up regretting. And I'm trying to tell you, you're going to raise all this, man. You can have a seat at the master's table today. Your best life today. Right? That's Joel's thing. But there's Bible today. I don't mean a new Cadillac every month or whatever, but my goodness, man. It's like, man, you're really going to do something for Jesus Christ today? Yeah, you can do that. And you can put a smile on your Savior's face, can't you? Yeah, you can. Watch this. Look at this mindset here. Ezekiel chapter 28, look at verse 1. Now the word of the Lord came again unto me, saying, Son of man, right? Say unto the prince of Tyrus, right? Now, what you'll see, this is the chapter that identifies the fall of Lucifer, amen. However, he's literally talking to about the king of Tyrus. The king of Tyrus is a man. But he's mentioning, you know, like, get me behind me, Satan type thing is what's going on here. Because Peter wasn't Satan, was he? But he's either influenced or whatever. He wasn't talking about the guy behind Peter. He's talking to Peter to get thee behind me because of that mindset. Well, the applicable part here is actually that there's a prince of Tyrus. Now watch this, and I don't want you to raise your hand or whatever, but man, because I see myself in your actions, the difference between the way you handle your business when you decide, well, I'll just do this. You think that, well, I'm just going to be over here, is just. You just keep using that word, just. It's just this. Just a little bit don't work, right? It's the way you look at it, right? And the way you, it's the reason why you hang out with the crowd you hang out with. Because they're just like you. Backsliders hang out with others. They're comfortable with other backsliders. They're always on the phone together. They ain't talking, it isn't you, it isn't them raising the other guy up, by the way. It's not that. It's you're all down in that pit again, that nasty cesspool of life. You're back up down in there again. Well, after you came out and said, hey, I'm done. Oh, man, I don't want to ever go back. Cannonball, isn't it? Oh, that's cannonball. Nice. Doing the can opener now. Flip, back, flip. Back into the pit. You go, hey. That's what they're doing. You're just doing that. You're just laying out. You're just neglecting your body. You're just not telling nobody. I mean, not everybody tells everybody about everything. Not everybody has tracks in their pocket. Not everybody's talking to each. You know, man, I don't have that gift of gab, like, you know, some people. But you think that by saying that over and over again excuses you from doing the work of an evangelist? I guess if you just repeat after, I just don't have it. It's just not in my personality, amen. You just keep repeating that to yourself. Because you've been doing it. That is absolutely no excuse whatsoever. That's an opportunity for God to use you. I can't do it. That's how he used Moses. He actually rebuked him. I think that's Exodus 3. But it sounded like Porky Pig or whatever he did. You want to go and say, what? Well, just be quiet. Aaron, help him out. And he delivered the armies out. He called them the armies out of Egypt. And he did it. The you saying, I can't do it, is the perfect opportunity for God to do it. Your inability to be able to look somebody in the eye and tell them about Jesus Christ, I can't do it, Lord says, perfect. It's exactly what I believe.
I can do that, then.
I'm all what? Lord says, sit. I need to know. But you are using that as your humility, you know, the whole, you know, humble yourself.
I just couldn't see myself, Pastor. That's just, I prefer to use a little tact, you know, in my own ability. And this whole going out into the street, it kind of making a fool. I just can't. It's just not in me.
Love says, you know, that's sincere. I mean, if that's sincere. That's just a show, but you just chicken. It could be that way. I told my wife, said, boy, that's funny how you call the priest and you say you don't like nobody. Now watch me move through. That's how it works, folks. Otherwise, you're like this fellow here. Watch. Move closer. Word of the Lord came again unto me, saying, Son of man, say unto the prince of Tyrus, thus saith the Lord God, because thine heart's lifted up, and thou hast said, I'm a God. I sit in the seat of God, in the midst of the seas. Yet thou art a man, and that's why you should be in church, because I'll remind you. You ain't that.
Yeah, look at me.
And that Bible says the way you look at it, your heart's lifted up many times during the course of the day, during the course of the month, during the course of the services. Yeah, what's that supposed to mean? I'm ahead of you. I've already read the whole thing about don't worry about their face stuff. That's Jeremiah. Don't look at their face. I've already read that. You looking crazy at me doesn't affect me. Matter of fact, that's like, at least I got that one. Amen. You're reminded. Look, remember how this works now. God uses people, and again, I don't know why he does this. He should just tell this to the prince himself, but you notice that ain't God talking. He's talking to Ezekiel. He says, the word of the Lord came again unto me. Ezekiel saying, Son of man, me, Ezekiel, say unto the prince of Tyrus. God's talking to Ezekiel, and Ezekiel's talking to the prince of Tyrus. God talks to me, and I talk to you. Oh, that's kind of charismatic. You have something to quote and all that. That's Bible. I don't know what else to tell you. Maybe you don't understand your Bible, how that works. You're waiting for God to say it. He did say it. Yes, last Sunday. But you weren't there. He did say it. But you didn't listen. He did say it. I object something else to do. And you know what? You put yourself in a position to be reminded. You're a man. You're just a man. I'm just a man. I read this, and it's like, well, I told you, when you look at this, I know, spiritually speaking, this is exactly where you take somebody to talk about, well, Satan was never an angel. He was a cherub. It says it twice in here. And this is the fall of verse 12. That's Satan, and that's Lucifer, rather. In verse 13, thou hast been in Eden, the garden of God. You know the prince of Tyre was never in the garden of God. So there's double application there, right? But this practical application of this real guy This is the devil talking. He's talking about Lucifer, but he's talking through the Prince of Tyre, which can be your average Baptist here, who says, I ain't going to do that. I don't know who you guys think you are when you keep telling me I got to go out on the street and tell people about Jesus Christ. I'm in charge. See, that's your thought. I do that. I get it. You ain't no different than me. That's probably why God, I know that's why God brought me here, because I'm a lot like you. How about that?
Why would I get you?
Why'd I get you? We'll go that route.
Well, the church only goes as high as the pulpit.
And I think the church only goes as high as the pew. Anything else? So let's just say, we'll just do this together then.
Amen.
How about this? You do your thing, I do my thing, man, and together we just do everything for God, and then, you know, yep. Maybe pick up some crowns or some gold and some silver and some precious stones on the way, man. And yep. We could just do what we can for what God's given us here in the back end of South Florida.
Amen.
Cats know we're here.
Yep.
And God knows we're here.
Yeah.
Right. You just keep living that route. And blame the world.
Yep.
Because you know what it says, the world says to you?
Yep.
Blank you.
Amen.
And blank your God, and blank that Bible, and blank your church, and get, and you got an order to wear a mask from a guy who wears a bra. And we're like, and you're going to fight me for that. You're going to fight me over that.
Yeah.
And you want to fight me, that's fine. You probably get me, especially now. I'm about to fall over. But for that, for real, you're gonna leave my church, you're gonna leave our church for that? I love my country, that's why we preach. What would you do for your country? Well, I went out with our church on Sunday and a boy got saved.
And that's
what we did for our country.
Right.
You see, he's probably here legally. And then we didn't have to drive all the way to Mexico to witness to him.
That's right.
Little broader Mexican all the way 500,000 miles away, right there. Walk past you.
Praise God.
My wife gave him a track, and then John Dunn, that dude with the slicks his hair back, man, he loves it. He needs to be. He's supposed to be here, by the way.
Right.
So pray for him, because he's got his own demons to fight. He tells me all the time,
man, the church I go to, man, they ain't right.
Because he knows enough Bible to be dangerous.
Yeah.
John Dunn? He knows enough Bible would be dangerous.
Yeah,
he does that.
Amen.
But he belongs one to him, his wife, and his two kids right there with the four chairs right
Amen.
There. But that's his fight.
Yeah.
Because, man, I thank God for my wife, man, I really do. Because that woman right there, and I say this quite often because it makes sense to me. Everywhere I've ever felt God calling me, that lady's the first one right there saying, okay. Now, everybody else says, oh, that ain't right. No, I don't think God's in that. That can't be. But that lady right there is like, okay. Matter of fact, she, before I even said amen to coming down here, she was looking crazy. Like, when God took that pastor home in Hialeah, you know what that means? That means he's dead, yeah. I know what that means. He's absent in the body, present of the Lord. He ain't suffering no more, you know, the mind. He said, that's not what that means. I'm just part of it. Anyway, what it meant. And then her girlfriend at the time was praying, door.
You think that you can bring us down to South Florida, Lord? That's an open door. You don't see it, though.
Like, Tony Romo, man, get us into the playoffs. You know, we're talking about going back down to the year. We need to buy another car. Lord said, that's the last new car you got. Look, verse 2. Son of man, say unto the prince, say unto the rich Barnett, thus saith the Lord God, because his heart's lifted up. He said, I am a God. He said, he sits in the seat of God, in the midst of the seas, yet he is a man. And Barnett, you know God. Although he set his heart as the heart of God. And you can just put your name next to it, brother. And you can write to the side of that. It says, mine says Satan, but then they, me. You can say, I mean, that's who that is. That's where you're going to find that he falls. But that's pretty close to how you have your business. Verse 3. Behold, thou art wiser than Daniel. There is no secret that they can hide from thee. With thy wisdom and with thine understanding, thou hast gotten thee riches, right? You need a life for yourself. Thou hast gotten gold, silver into thy treasures. You got your little nest egg, you got your little way of doing stuff, right? By thy great wisdom, look at all that. You got the gift, man. You got the look. By thy great wisdom and by thy traffic, thou hast increased thy riches, and thine heart is lifted up because of thy riches. Therefore, thus saith the Lord God, because thou hast set thine heart as the heart of God, behold, therefore I will bring strangers upon thee. The terrible of the nations, and they shall draw their swords against the beauty of thy wisdom, and they shall defile thy praises. You know what God's saying there? We'll close it down. You have this idea. I'm trying to tell you, man, your plans don't work out. Unless they line up with God, but they really do, right? Yeah. Your plans are like, I got one little bit going on here. Let me just be the king of my own castle. Just let me do things the way I want to do. I'll show up when I want to do. Pastor, stop calling. I'll do this, that, and the other thing. And then when I'm good and ready, I'll show up and I'll do a little bit of this. I'll bring some french fries. I'll go over here. Okay, you're done now. Where are you going to the street? No. Bye-bye. And then you go back to your little world. Your little world is, I got my little riches here, got my little gold, got my little car, got my new plants, I got all this, got my family started, man, I got all this stuff going on, the Lord says. Because you know better, right? He says, hey, you talking to me? Let me give you his address. Come on, listen to me. Hey, you give you that trouble, you're at it. The trouble, man. I'm talking about your own little thing you got going on, your own little me. The world of me, you know that one, the world of I. He gonna drown it out. Move the strings in there, just stomp all over. This is a great, great church. I don't know what you're waiting for. I don't know why you keep thinking there's something bigger coming. What else is coming? You think other churches, you see any other churches out there in this group? You hear see any other churches passing tracks out, leaving tracks? I don't see them getting any closer. I think we're pretty close, man, to doing what God wants us to do. How about this? Lord, yeah. Help me make the commitment because I'm not ready yet. Prayer night. Lord, yeah. Make it 1 year, 13, 12, 12. Every time you come in, whatever. It's not my issue how you get there. Get there, though. Because the flood's coming. The strangers are about to come. The only reason I'm here is because I had to go through that. And Ezekiel 28 to get here. You can don't ask my wife. But Jim, I'm telling you, Chief, if you were going to die, still don't ask. She won't tell you. I had to go through it. Now, are you happy that you now got you the way? Oh, now, hindsight's going to.
Oh, hindsight, I'm like, yeah, amen, I can handle it.
And I was 30 pounds. I had the wickedest thoughts about, you know, everything. And I was dark place. Dark place. Back like when I was on safeguard, you know, about how I could possibly lose everything as a father who had a house, you know, how in the world am I going to? I wasn't in a position to realize how big that was. Because I kept just denying his presence in my life. Although I went through emotions like a lot of people doing that. And it hit me. Like a tidal wave. Just like that over there. And for like 3 months, I had beat down to the ground. And God literally took my family. And I was living in a little kid's bed in one tree and that deal right there, man. For over about a year and a half. Start all over me and then I get saved all over me. How to read my Bible? I was saved for 25 years at that point. And I had a thing when I was getting born again. Man, I mean, like, who cares, man? How many times have you been saved? Twice. I tell you twice, man. That second time was rough, though. That second time getting right. That one, at that level, to get me to move and then be alone by myself. The only thing I have is that King James Bible and Final Fight Reader. I wouldn't wish that on you. I mean, if it's what it takes to bring you to your senses, then my prayer is, Lord, take me. I love my kids. That's a tough prayer, Lord. Whatever it takes, get them right. So, give you yourself. We worked that off. You know what I'm saying? Had a great God. The Bible testifies before it. I mean, so much so you couldn't even, you can't figure it out. You can't. It'll bring you a new car or whatever. So my prayer to you is for you, like I hope it would be for us. Stay faithful. So we worked it off. We didn't have it. We talking to Scott and I be talking about, man, I keep laughing with Scott. Over here, and look at that, oh yeah, what's that? I said, man, I said, that new music. Brother Mike's knees ain't bothering me. His dad's big foot ain't gonna bother me. He's flying around. Oh yeah, Father, bless the day we thank you for, bless the night, rather. Lift us all up to you, Father. We are a needy bunch, like we have said multiple times. God, I pray you help disapprove here. Help our church, help these individuals, give them desire to want to take that next step. Help me as a pastor, husband, friend, dad. I ain't none worried. We'll work this world doesn't have anything for us. And if we're listening, he'll tell us. So Lord, keep them encouraged, help them, bless them. Lord, whatever's holding them back, whatever, I pray for their spouses, Lord. It's a whole, whatever's holding them back. God, I pray you just continually work on them. And Lord, help this place be a haven from the world, this church here. And God, an opportunity, Father, to be able to reach people and to support each other and pray for each other. So we love and thank you, of course. Father, we pray you come soon. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. That good there, little man?
Hey, push, it says save on there. Is it stop or it says saving?
It says finish.
You just stopped it, right?
Finish?
No, yeah. Let me hit it real quick.
The one says, and it should have.